All right, so in the previous lecture, we have discussed several notions which may be treated as various versions of orthogonality. We consider it orthogonality which came directly from from inner product of two cycles. And when we introduce more advanced version of focal orthogonality, as we called it, and it was also given through the inner product in a sense, but we make some reflection of cycles and more involved construction behind that second orthogonality. And that in a sense again represent certain relations which describe angles between cycles. And now we wish to present certain geometrical values which may be treated in metric sense as distances. And to this end, we again come back to the geometrical description of our cycles. So we essentially consider it the representation of cycle either as the analytical curve by its quadratic equation or in term of matrices. So let us take some geometrical interpretation of these values. So if we will calculate the determinant of such a matrix, where we will use just straightforward value of imaginary unit which correspond to the complex numbers, usual imaginary unit I, then the determinant of this matrix will be given by such an expression, if I am not mistaken in my calculations. And let us see geometrical meaning of this value. So we start from the equation of a cycle, again in term of the circles, and we use the normalized form, the normalized quadratic equation, which correspond to the value of parameter k equal to 1. So we have equation, quadratic equation for a circle of the form like that. Standard exercise in analytical geometry allow us to find the center and radius of corresponding circles. So we complete squares here. So we got U minus L squared plus V minus N squared. And to make that calculation correct, we put the corresponding elements which need to be added and subtracted on the other side of the equation. And that is known to be the square of the radius of our circle. And as you can see, it exactly minus determinant of the matrix C, as we calculated before, for the case k equal 1. So geometrical meaning of determinant of this matrix in case of circles, just a square of the radius. So that is simple calculation. And what is also follow from our construction, what we made our calculation in the basic situation where we have the imaginary unit from complex numbers, but for other imaginary units which are admitted here, so it may be of any of three type, it shall be also some geometrical meaning. For example, if we will calculate the determinant in terms of the parabolic imaginary unit squared to zero, when the interpretation, geometrical interpretation of this value would be just the length of distance between real roots. So on that presentation, if we draw our cycles as parabolas, when the distance between Z1 and Z2 is parabolic determinant of that circles. And relation between that determinant and square of the radius for the cycles, in particular, explain why we treated the zero radius cycles as representative of certain points. So it's indeed, if we will compare with our analytical expression, when we see what zero radius with zero determinant cycles in some sense encode the point. So it's just produce a certain description of the point with the corresponding center. Now, question is, we have cycles, and somehow if we normalize it by the condition k equal 1, when determinant of cycle give us some metrical information, square of its radius, say, or some other geometrical object. How we may use that size of the cycles, define it through the determinant, to find, say, distances between two points. And one of possibility is done in variational manner. So it's represented on the right-hand side picture on presentation. When we have two points, Z1 and Z2 on our plane, when we draw all possible cycles passing these two points and select one with the minimal or maybe with maximal size. So that variational definition produces the distance between two points in terms of the diameter of in terms of a cycle with diameter defined by these two points. So that definition can be carried out not only for circles but for two other situations with parabolas and hyperbolas as well. So when we try to do it for parabolic situation and we take that two points Z3 and Z4 and we'll draw all possible parabolas passing these two points and calculate where parabolic determinant. As you remember, parabolic determinant on the left hand side picture is describing the distance between roots, real roots of this parabola. So to obtain the maximal or minimal value for that distance is possible when our parabola degenerate into two vertical lines. So we make our parabola more and more slim. So focus passing to the infinity, tending to the infinity. So that two parabola degenerate into two vertical lines. That will be the corresponding parabolic version of distances in between points Z3 and Z4. But it's clear from this definition what that distance depends only from the projection of points Z3 and Z4 to the real axis. So vertical component, vertical coordinate does not play any role in this distance. Only projection to horizontal direction are important. And that somehow reflect a certain degeneracy between in parabolic case, and it's again related to the definition of metric. So if you come back and try to define a distance between points in terms of our imaginary unit I, so then it may be defined as in complex analysis. So we multiply a hypercomplex unit with its complex conjugation, so it's complex conjugation. So this is U plus IV U minus IV or that produce U minus I squared V squared. So in parabolic case, if this is equal to zero, that reduced only to U squared. Again, that distance depends only from the first component, not from the second component. That is certain degeneracy which better to resolve in a different way. And there is a such possibility. We may define even more metrical properties in terms of our cycles, and that will be called length. Again, imagine what you have a device, say compass, who is able to draw your cycles. So in previous situation, we draw a cycle just passing both our points Z1 and Z2. So we calculate the distance between point using such cycles. Now we may do a different construction. We put one leg of our compass to a one point and then pass with a cycle the second point with the second leg of our compass. Well, as you remember, with every cycle we associate two type of special points, which is centers and focus. And the centers can be of three different type: elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. And foci can be similarly elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. And then we can draw our cycle either circles, parabolas, or hyperbolas. And then we can calculate its size using imaginary unit in the this matrix, Schwenzinger, Filmer-Springer, Knops matrix. That imaginary units also can be of any of three possible types. So all together we have quite a lot of various possibilities. So having just two points on the plane, we have 54 different possibilities how to define a length between two points. That is really looks like a lot, and maybe initial guess what not all of these lengths are meaningful or geometrically significant, but we will see soon what in, there is enough reason to consider all of them and try to interpret and reuse some geometrical information which came out of this length. We have good intuition about compass drawing a circle. Let's discuss briefly how it looks like if we are drawing parabolas. So on the left picture A, we draw the several parabolas which are concentric. So these parabolas have the same center, it's drawn on the picture, and they have a different radius as it's seen. So radius, parabolic radius, is just the distance between roots of this parabola. So it's possible to use that center as one point and then choose a parabola which with center which pass another point and then measure distance by means of its roots. This is a calculation of a length from the center. And similarly, we can calculate the distance from the foci. So here is again a parabola on the right hand side picture, drawn several parabolas with the same focus. So this again we draw parabolic focus. So this is the vertex of parabola, and parabola have different size. So again we can choose a parabola with given focus and passing the second point. So that will produce examples of these lengths which we are interested in. So now, what is relation of described distances and lengths with our study of geometry in the spirit of Erlangen program? As you remember, by definition, we need to look on in certain invariants under action of Möbius transformation, and we used for this definition cycles which are invariant, make an invariant family for Möbius transformation. So there is a certain hope what our construction is related to the Erlangen program, and for majority of distances and lengths which was defined before, we do not have invariance property in proper sense. They are changed by action of Möbius transformation. In particular, the determinant of the matrix which we define for a cycle also will be changed by the Möbius transformation. It's easy to see if we apply the corresponding action of Möbius transformation on this matrix, when it break K normalization, so K will not will be equal to 1, we will need to rescale that matrix once more, and that will produce a different value for determinant. Although determinant itself is invariant under action of SL2R, but K normalization is not invariant under Möbius transformation, and that breaks the invariance of distances and lengths. That effect is already can be observed in the complex analysis. Möbius transformation, which are rather important in complex analysis, they do not preserve usual Euclidean length, but it is known what they Möbius transformation are conformal mapping. That means they preserve infinitesimal distances. That means small circles are transformed into small circles. And there is a certain coefficient of proportionality at every point which map a circle of small radius to another circle of small radius and radius multiplied by that coefficient. So that is a definition of conformality. It's given in as a limit. So we calculate distance d between two transformed points, and then observe the fraction of this distance between a transformed point and distances with the original points. If limit for this fraction exists when t tends to zero for small transformations, for small displacement of a point y, then we are speaking about conformality of our distances and lengths. And result of investigation shows what distances, this is what we defined in term of variational size of cycle passing two points, they are conformal if we are using the same type of geometry in point space and in cycle space. That means if we calculate the value of this determinant exactly using the same imaginary unit, which is used for the shape of corresponding analytical curve, so circles, parabolas, or hyperbolas. So here I and I brief shall be of the same type to produce a conformal distance. So out of 9 possible conformal distances, only 3 are out of 9 possible 3 times 3 different distances, only 3 are conformal. On the other hand, for the lengths, there are 54, as you remember from previous slides, different lengths. All of them are conformally are conformal. So we may mix any geometry of points with any geometry of cycles and calculate the size of corresponding cycles in any way, use any center or any focus. In any case, we obtain a conformal center, and can obtain the conformal length. So that is a rather interesting result, and indeed variety of geometries which appears from that is rather impressive. Yet, again, if we will be inspired by classical complex analysis, we know what the, besides conformality of usual Euclidean distance, there is another property which is known as isometry in the Lobachevsky plane. So there is a possibility to introduce on the upper half plane of complex numbers, so-called Lobachevsky distance. Sometimes it's called hyperbolic distance, but that name is not in good agreement with terminology which we are using here. Upper half plane in our with complex numbers in our language would be elliptic one. So I will avoid that hyperbolic name for Lobachevsky distance. And it's known what Lobachevsky distance is invariant under Möbius transformation. And there is a general statement, whenever we have a certain function of two points which are invariant under Möbius transformation in the upper half plane, it will be a function of this expression. And expression inside is that key ingredient for the Lobachevsky half plane. We need to take F capital to be hyper inverse hyperbolic sign of function of that value. So this is the result, which is true for all three geometries. So if we will use geometry in all three different values, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic, and just apply that to calculation to the corresponding algebraic properties of hypercomplex numbers, that result can be demonstrated similarly. Well, again, nice property or important property of mathematics, what we may oftenly turn a certain theorem into definitions. In particular, we know a theorem from Euclidean geometry saying what straight line deliver the shortest distance between two points. And that means what if you calculate so in general, in Euclidean geometry, we have triangle inequality. So we have A, B, and C. In general, C is less or equal than A plus B. And it's known if you have these two points A and B and know a distance C between them, then choose a certain point on the plane D in such a way what AB, A plus B will be equal to C, then that point D have to belong to the straight line, in to the segment AB, shall be in between of A and B, for that triangle inequality turn into identity. So that is known property of Euclidean geometry. And we may turn it into definition. Actually, Blumenthal, I think, is the first one who used that trick. So he defined a line as a curve such what given function, which we call a distance, is additive along that curve. So additive in this sense. So we have an invariant distance highlighted on the presentation, and we are wondering what would be Blumenthal lines according to that invariant distance. Well, because distance is Möbius invariant, when according to definition of Blumenthal line shall be also Möbius invariant, and we already know the family of Möbius invariant curves on the plane. This is cycles. And it's not surprising, not surprising, what Blumenthal line in our Möbius invariant geometry will be indeed delivered by cycles. In particular, we are interested with non-degenerate distance in the parabolic geometry. And for parabolic geometry, that invariant distance can be delivered by such a formula where we use certain function in front of the that expression, and that function is a usual inverse sine or hyperbolic inverse sine, or just function 2x, which may be treated as parabolic version of inverse sine, as we discussed with some trigonometry in our corresponding this part. Then Blumenthal line will be simply parabolas. Probably, again, I will recall how things are looking in the Lobachevsky geometry. So in Lobachevsky geometry, this is the picture which we had before. So here is the point I, imaginary unit, and here orbits which we have around rotation around point I. This is a collection of points equidistant from the I. So in term of Lobachevsky geometry, orbits consist of the points on the same distance from the point I. And then Blumenthal line will be orthogonal to that equidistant collection of sets, and that will be the wet circles which are orthogonal to the real axis. So in Lobachevsky geometry, straight lines, Blumenthal lines, are arcs of circles which are orthogonal to the real axis. This is standard complex analysis theory. So let us see how it's turned out to work in our setup. Again, we have here presented different geometry. The upper left picture is that picture from the Lobachevsky geometry. Green circles represent points on the fixed distance, same distance from the imaginary unit. And blue one represent the straight lines. So in this case, these are orthogonal to the real axis. In the case when we use wet calculations or wet rules in parabolic situation, when we have a variety, a certain variety of choices. If you remember at some point when we discuss relation between elliptic, parabolic and hyperbolic geometries, I put that symbolic picture saying what we have a parameter which may change continuously with certain specific reference point, and that reference point it correspond to parabolic values, and on one side we have hyperbolic value of parameter, and on another side we have elliptic value of parameter. So parabolic one has that boundary position, and somehow it's inherit being a special case. It's somehow able to absorb a certain property both from elliptic and hyperbolic situation. So in that middle point, that three different geometry really may coexist or may have that different flavor. And we have a certain illustration of this type on this picture. So for parabolic geometry, we have upper central picture, which more correspond to the situation with the Lobachevsky geometry. So, and again, here green lines represent the points on the same distance from the imaginary unit. And then blue lines represent that Blumenthal lines. Blue parabolas represent Blumenthal lines in corresponding geometry. So that picture somehow structurally similar to Lobachevsky geometry. And we may build a similar construction in the contents of hyperbolic geometry. Here, again, I already mentioned it on several occasions, what the geometry of double numbers, hyperbolic numbers, is somehow a good model for Minkowski-type space-time geometry. And here we have oftenly appearing a light cone, which separates space-time region from time-like region. And here, when we define Blumenthal lines and corresponding distances, that means, again, what for the elliptic situation, when distance is calculated, it's always non-negative. But in hyperbolic distances, when we have the corresponding minus sign in front of second parameter, then there are, of course, three possibilities. It can be strictly less than zero, it can be equal to zero, or it can be bigger than zero. So there are three possibilities for the that distance. And when it's equal to zero, it will be the light cone, which join the points which can be which reflected the propagation of the speed of light, when according to agreement values less than zero correspond to space-time region, space-like region, and if it's bigger than zero, it's time-like region. Depending from the sign of that hyperbolic matrix, we have three two type of behavior. And here the Blumenthal lines on upper hyperbolic picture, it's drawn for the space-time region, space-like region, and here is for time-like region. So in every case, it is blue Blumenthal lines are represented as hyperbolas, but this is a different kind of hyperbolas. And in parabolic situation, we may see a similar two similar pictures. So that is behave more like that geometry with intersection of the real axis, hyperbolic one, with the space-like region, and that is a geometry where, as you can see, in the hyperbolic situation, we have here in lower picture the hyperbolas which do not touch or do not cross the real axis. So if you depart from imaginary axis and travel along the time-like curve, you cannot reach that region. Similar behavior here happen for the parabolas. So here is parabolas which are not reaching the real axis, and on upper picture there are parabolas which necessarily intersect real axis. So here parabolic geometry, it somehow inherit both behaviors from the elliptic and parabolic situation. Now we came again to the consideration of zero radius cycles. And when we deal with zero radius cycles, and we had nine possibilities for them, I will find it. We in that situation, we discuss what these zero radius cycles nicely represent points in elliptic situation, when here zero radius cycle simply represents the point, the center of this cycle. And in hyperbolic case, we again have a nice representation for a point on the plane. Zero radius, hyperbolic zero radius cycle, which is simply a light cone, uniquely define that point where the origin of the light cone. But in parabolic situation, again, there is a certain degeneracy. Zero radius parabolas does not describe that point, which is its center, in a nice way. As you can see, here we are having that parabolas of non-degenerate type, which passing that center. And we may try to define the parabolas which are suitable to describe a point in a way which are shown on the left picture on presentation. So we may shrink, again, to describe a point, we may take concentric circles and shrink the radius to the zero. That will be description of the center. For hyperbolas, we take hyperbolas with corresponding center and shrink radius to the zero when we obtain in the limit that light cone. For parabolas, it's better not to take parabolas which are concentric, but it's better to take cofocal parabolas, parabolas with the same focus, and then shrink focal distance to the zero. When in the limit, we will obtain that half the ray origin in the focus of our parabola, and that ray will be a good description for a point in language of parabolic geometry, which may be used in many applications when we need to represent a point by a certain corresponding circle of small size. When there is a possibility to describe the relation between points and cycles. In particular, that relation can be again described in term of orthogonality. So assume I have a cycle, which I denote this time by Z, which has a zero radius. So that means determinant of Z is equal to zero. And let I have another cycle, ordinary one, maybe with non-zero radius, C. How to describe geometrical relation, what the point corresponding to the zero radius cycle Z belong to the cycle C. That condition, what this is C, this is Z, that for the case of circles and hyperbolas, that relation can be given by orthogonality condition as we defined before. Again, some simple calculation shows what the zero radius cycle belong to C if they are orthogonal in ordinary sense. That work for circles and hyperbolas, but does not work for parabolas. For parabolas, we may try to use that small cofocal parabolas which we described before on this presentation, in this slide. And then we want a similar orthogonality condition. We want to be have a similar orthogonality condition when we have that cycle C and that infinitesimal cycle Z belong to C, to be expressed as orthogonality, but usual orthogonality does not work for it. So it's turned out what we need to use that second focal orthogonality, and if we use if we use that second focal orthogonality, then indeed Z orthogonal in that not symmetric way to C will encode the geometrical information what C passing the origin of Z. So that focal orthogonality, which was rather fancy and maybe initially looks not very natural, has such a geometrical interpretation. But we may further illustrate usefulness of that focal orthogonality as follow. So we started from orthogonality relation, and we define it in terms of right angles, say, for circles at the origin, originally. But it's known also what orthogonality related to metric properties. So in particular, orthogonality of lines deliver the shortest distance. So if you have a point A, as on the right picture of presentation, and you are looking for the shortest distance to a straight line, then you need to drop a perpendicular to that line. So that is again known property, and as we did with Blumenthal line, we may turn now a theorem of Euclidean geometry into a definition of non-Euclidean geometry. So we define perpendicularity of two cycles in a similar way, or perpendicularity of two vectors in a similar way. We are saying what a vector AB is perpendicular to a vector CD if a small displacement along the vector CD from point B only increase our distance. So that is the natural definition, and that may come, although it's look like, again, definition of the property defined on the angle, at the origin of this definition, there is a corresponding notion of the distance. We need to measure distances to define that perpendicularity. And it's turned out, again, if we will use the parabolic length defined in term of, say, focal length, as it was done before, then that perpendicularity reduced to focal orthogonality for parabolas, which was given before. So that definition in term of focal length reduced to focal orthogonality. So that is, again, another justification why focal orthogonality has geometrical significance in that setup. Well, probably we have a large topic related to the other model of our geometry. We describe geometry so far for the upper half plane, and there is equivalent description in term of unit disk, but better to start that topic on a new lectures. So let's do it on the next week. Are there any questions? Please do not forget to make your registration, because administration of the courses is interested to see are you